according to his sahih, from the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that there was a man by the name of Thumamah ibn Asad. That man was a leader from Al-Yamama. And he killed so many Muslims. And he was taken as a prisoner of war. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tied him to one of the pillars in his masjid sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to him and he said, "Mada indaka ya Thumama? What do you have to say, Thumama?" And Thumama said three options. He said, "In taqtul, taqtul zadam. If you were to kill me, I have a tribe behind me that will not let it go. Wa in ta'fu, ta'fu an kareem. And if you were to forgive me, I'll be very grateful to you. Wa in kana al-mal, fatlub minhu ma shi'. If it was about money, ask how much money you want. As a ransom, it will be given to you." The Prophet ﷺ left him. Second day, the Prophet ﷺ stopped at him again, asked him the question, and he gave the same answer. Third day, same question, same answers. And all what the Prophet ﷺ did after that, he said, "Atlaqu saraha." Set him free. And the man went to a close by space where he took a shower and he came back to the masjid. And he stood in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka Rasulullah." He took shahada. But look at what he said after that. He said, "Wallahi, ma kana أقرها على قلبي من وجه أكثر من وجهك." There was no more disgusting face to look at more than your face. ولكن الآن ليس هناك أحب من وجه إلى قلبي أحب من وجهك. But now there is no more beloved face on earth that I'd love to look at except your face, Prophet of Allah. لم يكن هناك دين أكره إلى قلبي من دينك. There was no more disgusting religion, more than religion to my heart. But now, there is no religion more beloved to my heart except your religion, Prophet of Allah. There was no land more hated in my heart than your land. But today, there is no more land more beloved to my heart more than your land. Why am I sharing this story? What happened to Thumama ibn Athal when he was left in the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, or what I might call the Islamic center at that time, or a da'wah center at that time, that changed the heart of that man within 3 days? Think about this. It is the way the Prophet ﷺ treated him. It's the way he saw the true believers, the best generation, the Sahaba, behaving in the masjid in front of him, that turned his heart. He was not giving lectures about Islam. He saw how the Prophet ﷺ is dealing with the Sahaba and how the Sahaba should respect to him. That what changed his heart. That's why he became a Muslim. How many times have we come to the masjid? How many times? What do we see in the masjid today? Is it something welcoming? Is it smiling brothers loving each other? Or groups in every pocket of the masjid attacking the others? We're attacking each other. We're even attacking the Imam himself. Who's the Imam? If the Prophet ﷺ was alive today, he'd be the one giving the khutbah now. if we are one ummah. But the ummah expanded. This is why an imam is somebody who represents the Prophet ﷺ, coming to guide you, coming to share knowledge with you. So what is the meaning of a masjid? What is the meaning of an Islamic center? Is it a place that's welcoming everyone? Children, teenagers, youth, women, men, elderly? Or is it a place for the elderly people, the uncles and the aunties? And it's like, it sounds like a country club where they come and they pray and they go home. What's a masjid? What's an Islamic center? It's the place established by a group of people networking for their own personal interest, or is it a place for all the Muslims to come together and learn the deen of Allah? The word masjid comes from sujood. So is it a place where we come and do sujood while our hearts are everywhere? Do you love the person standing next to you? I know people of the same family members, and each one of them comes to me and say, make dua for him because he doesn't talk to me. I was the one who brought him to this country and he's ungrateful to me. And they're praying in the same row in the masjid. What did we learn from our prayers? Do we benefit from our prayers? Is it moving up and down and then going home? It's the place where we learn akhlaq. So when you leave this masjid, you can't start lying and backbiting. When you see your brother next to you making a mistake, do you go to him and give him advice? The masjid of the Prophet's time was not a masjid for the tribe of the Prophet. What are our masajid today? Some Arabs come together, they make a masjid. It's an Arab masjid. Some Pakistanis come together, they make a masjid. It's a Pakistani masjid. Does it represent the entire community? Think about this. And everybody in the masjid, they want to bring their cultural package here. So they want the imam to look like the imam back home. They want the masjid to be like exactly like the way it's run back home. We're in a different world. We're in a different era. Is our masjid welcoming children, teenagers, women? Leave women without knowledge. And I guarantee you, in two generations, there will be Muslim. There will be no Muslim in this country. What's our main concern? To come and pray five times a day and go home? Was that what the Prophet ﷺ told his Sahaba? No, the masjid was an open Islamic university where the Prophet ﷺ taught them akhlaq before anything else. Because if you do ibadah, if you do the five times every day and you still lie and backbite and slander, you didn't benefit from your ibadah. The essence of this deen is summed up by the Prophet ﷺ in one hadith. He said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمْ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I have been sent to you for only one purpose, to perfect the standard of good behavior. Not to perfect the way you're standing, or what are you dressed? Are you covering your head or not? Are you wearing a jubba or not? That was not the main thing. There's nothing called Islamic uniform. The Prophet ﷺ was not wearing something like this at his time, or something like that, or something like that. He was covering his aura. That's the main thing. Let's look at the comprehensive message of Islam. Islam is coming to change you to submit to Allah and to be sincere to Allah. How can the masjid be run? How can the Islamic center be run? What's an Islamic center? It's a building, administration, and imam. That's what it is. A building is a place for people. Administration to maintain the building, to take care of the money coming in and going out, to take care of cleaning the masjid, And an imam is to lead the community with the help of those people administering the masjid. But how do we look to an imam today? It's like back home. An imam is somebody who failed at school. So he goes to the madrasa, memorizes the Quran, and you bring him to where Jummah cover his head and lead the salah, and that's it. That's not an imam. That's a hafiz of the Quran. He has no vision. He's not a leader. He doesn't take care of every single member of the whole community. The word imam, by definition, in Arabic language means a leader. This is why you all stand behind him, even if you are the president of the country, if you are the king of the country. But in our culture, not in our religion, the imam is an employee that we hire and we tell him what to do and what to say. You should be dressed like this, you should talk about this, you should talk about this, then you should be the imam. Because we are all imams, mashallah. Let's go back to the reality of this deen. Why this ummah is backward? Why are we losing our children? Because we are all leaders and we are all imams. We all give fatwas. And if the imam talks to tell people what's right, somebody yells at him in the house of Allah. What type of behavior is this? Is this acceptable in Islam? Would anybody talk to the Prophet ﷺ back while he's talking? You know what Allah said? Do not even raise your voice in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ. Otherwise, all your deeds will be null and void. So if somebody is telling the Prophet ﷺ said, and you say, no, this is wrong. I didn't hear this before. Who are you? Are you a scholar? Is that leadership? You know, Imam Malik, when people came to learn the hadith from him, and somebody would walk with him in the street outside and say, teach me a hadith, he said, shame on you. You want me to teach you the words of the Prophet ﷺ while I'm walking in the street? No. Come to the masjid. Have wudu. Sit like a student of knowledge. Then I can teach you the words of the Prophet ﷺ. Imagine somebody saying, the Prophet ﷺ said, and somebody said, no, this is wrong. And later when he says, I'm sorry, I didn't know this. Let's respect our leaders. This is the only way we can prosper and move forward. Enough is enough. So the leader of the imam is somebody who is coming with a vision for the entire community. He makes halaqas to get the kids to love the Quran. And that's alhamdulillah what we did in this center. We did a halaqa, time for Quran for the kids. And they used to call us. And alhamdulillah, I'm restarting this soon because I was going under so much stress after the loss of my sister. But alhamdulillah, I'm recovering now. We're going to continue all our programs. When we have a program to take care of our teens and we create leadership, how much time do I do as an imam behind the scenes to prepare those young leaders for that? How many hours does it take? An imam takes care of the entire community. How many marriages are being fixed every day? How many people call me to go and fix their marriages at home? So for me, it's one time to leave the masjid 10 minutes or 15 minutes before Salah because I have an emergency to go and fix a family problem because the man was about to kill his wife and divorce her. That's more important for me than leading the Salah. Anybody can lead the Salah. So for somebody to take this and go around in the community and say, what type of imam is this? How could he be a role model? He's leaving the masjid 2 minutes before Salah. What type of community is this? What type of leadership is this? And I told you many times from this member that imam is not infallible. The imam can make mistakes. He's a human being. The Sahaba made mistakes. When you see me making a mistake, even without giving me husnul dhan, the benefit of the doubt, come and talk to me. Don't talk about me. Then you can fix the problem. You will know why they leave the masjid 10 minutes before the salah instead of distorting the image of your Imam in front of everyone. That's not leadership. That's not akhlaq. That's not the essence of this deen. So an imam is someone who takes care of women. Because if you teach a woman, she will teach her children. A da'wah center is supposed to be da'wah. You know what's da'wah? We should go outside and invite the non-Muslims. And alhamdulillah, very soon, you will see the first shahada in this Islamic center. Very soon, inshallah. A da'wah center should not have an imam who will cover his head, wear a jubba, lead the five times, leaving 10,000 Muslims outside, never coming to the masjid. His job is to bring the people from outside the masjid to the masjid. That's da'wah. If the imam sits here, leads the salah, he's leading those who are already in the masjid. Where is his da'wah? That's the vision of an imam. And we should all facilitate this. Some of you sitting here, I spend time with them between Asr till Isha. Some of them were not praying. Alhamdulillah, they're coming to the masjid. And this is why some people say, where is the imam in Maghrib? He's doing da'wah outside. He's reaching out to the hospitals, to the jail, to the sick people at their homes. He's having circles with young children who will never come to the masjid, that you yourself come to me and say, Shaykh, I always tell my son, pray. He said, okay, I will pray. He will not pray. Even if he prays, it's going to be mechanical movements just to please you. Not because he loves Allah. Because you never taught him to love Allah. That's what I'm doing now. I go to private people and I sit with circles of young Muslims. Believe it or not, they're leaving Islam. And those uncles who insist that I should be here in the masjid five times just to lead the salah, they are the same ones who come to me individually and say, please, my daughter is at the university now and I discovered recently that she's a girlfriend. Allahu Akbar. Why, brother? He said, I've been killing myself working for the last 20 years to protect her and to ensure her future. I said, but you forgot one main thing. Did you get her to love Allah? Did you get her to watch Allah while she's away from you? No. You used to give her instructions. Pray now. She's like, okay. She'll take the prayer mat, go into the room. She'll not pray. Did you pray? Alhamdulillah. Then when I see her at the university, when I see her at any gathering, she says, I don't believe in Allah. I don't even believe in Islam. Like I was just born in a Muslim and my dad forces me to pray. Who's Allah? I believe in evolution that she started at school. Where are the uncles? They are in the masjid praying. And they're working. See, teenagers are smiling because this is exactly what's happening in their life. They can relate to what I'm saying. So wake up, Ummah. If you want to move forward, have a vision. Have a mission. We don't build places to come and pray. That's not Islam. Prayer is part of your life. If it doesn't change your akhlaq, congratulations for the physical exercise. You didn't benefit by your salah. You do siyam because you fear Allah, you learn taqwa. Where is that? You just finished Ramadan, and when you are alone, you start backbiting people. Where is Islam in your life? So let's change our perspective and our attitude. Imams back home are some people who dropped school, they went to madrasa, and they should be given the leftovers of people. Let me introduce myself to you because that would never happen before. My name is Reda Bedeir. I'm a PhD from Al-Azhar University. I've been a professor there for 20 years. I'm not a sheikh, I'm not an imam. This is why, alhamdulillah, when I signed my contract with the brothers here, I said resident scholar. And we had a contract for a qari to come from Egypt to lead the salah. And that was the agreement from day one. And I have the contract with me of the imam. If anybody wants to have it, to look, have a look at it. So for people now to come and fight over, where is the imam? Wake up. You don't bring somebody with a PhD and 25 years of experience just to lead the salah. I can bring you one of my students to lead the salah. We need to understand the larger vision of an imam. An imam is not an employee to be controlled or to be managed. An imam is a leader, and alhamdulillah, that's what I agreed with the brothers from day one. And in our first meeting, they introduced me to everyone, Dr. Bedeir is coming here to lead. That was the understanding, and I hope it will continue, inshallah. That's the meaning of an imam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله. الحمد لله وكفى وصلاة وسلاما على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد أيها الأحبة في الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل As I said before, a masjid cannot be for one culture. A masjid cannot be for a group of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, because some people when they come together and they build a masjid, they assume ownership of that place. They feel that this is our place. Everybody has the right to come to this masjid. Every culture has the right to come to this masjid. And everybody has to be respected. And everybody has to be treated fairly. Nobody is favored over other. That's Islam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Al-Jinn, ayah number 18, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا The masajid are the houses of Allah. If somebody contributed to the masjid by your donation, by being a volunteer, by being a board member, may Allah reward you immensely. But the masjid belongs to Allah. And everybody is welcome to the masjid, regardless of your color, of your culture. If a young Muslim comes back here, and he was not practicing, and he's coming in shorts. What should we react to him? Get out of the masjid, astaghfirullah. You're not even dressed properly. Is this the way the Prophet would do that? The Prophet, I started the khutbah with Thumama. Thumama ibn Athal, who's a mushrik, who's a kafir. The Prophet brought him to the masjid for 3 days. What about a Muslim who's coming back to Islam? There was a lady from the First Nation that came a couple of days ago, after Salat al-Maghrib al-Isha, she was outside, she was looking. Who should respond to her? The Imam. So I just walked all the way to her. And of course, I can't force her to be dressed properly. She's coming, she said, I've seen this, I've never been to a mosque. I just wanted to see how the mosque looks like. So I just talked to her nicely. This is Islam. Some brothers walked by, and they were making fun of the Imam, and they were talking about the Imam. Why? This is the culture. This is the ignorance. The imam is standing with a woman who is not dressed in hijab. Who is that woman? Allahu Akbar. Is this Islam? Is this Islam? It really hurts so much if this is our understanding of Islam. This is a da'wah center. It opens its gates for everyone. We bring politicians here. Why? Not to make networking with them. To tell them this is Islam. This is the spirit of Islam. We only love Allah and we're sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're not bringing here for networking or for having something personal. No. We're bringing you here to teach you this is Islam. Islam welcomes everyone. This is the message of Islam. If somebody makes a mistake, how should we react to that? The Prophet told us. He said, مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدٍ Somebody sees something wrong, let him change by hand. By hand is the authority of the ruler. It's not left for everyone. It's going to be chaotic if everybody's going to fix everything by his own hand. But what's the role of the imam? What's the role of the administration? The imam is in full charge of religious affairs. This is his area. And for somebody to manage him, he has to have more qualification than him in that field. So you bring an imam, let him an imam. Let him be the imam. When it comes to religion, if anybody comes to you, oh, the imam is doing this, the imam is not doing this, go and talk to the imam. No. They respect the imam too much to the degree that they can't talk to the imam. That's not humbleness. That's fake humbleness. The Sahaba used to go to the Prophet and ask him all the time. You don't have to go through someone. So if it's religion, give it to the one who's specialized in religion. If it's administration, maintenance, go to the administration. Very simple. But if somebody comes to you and says, so-and-so is complaining of this, I say, bring him to me. If that person doesn't come to me, then what should I do? I should address this in public. But do I mention the name of the person? No. All my khutbas are recorded. You can go back to them. I never mention the name of a person. Because some people are spreading rumors that the imam is talking publicly about individuals and they're running away from the masjid. No. I never mention anyone by name. And that's how the Prophet used to rectify and correct things. Somebody does something and he says, someone did this, someone said this. And the right thing to do is this. So when we talk about the mistake, not the person who committed the mistake, teach me then if I'm doing the wrong thing as an imam. This is how we can correct things. This is what wise leadership is. But if you feel that you are the one who did this, then there is something wrong with you. You should go and make tawbah. It has nothing to do with somebody correcting you or guiding you. Otherwise, if I don't do this, I am deceiving this ummah. I don't deserve to be the imam. So my job, if I see something wrong, I should talk about it. And I should say why it is wrong and what is the right way to do it. That's the job of the imam. So I hope we change our concept. We change our attitude. And we give each one his own role and respect that. That way, we'll be moving forward. Otherwise, this ummah will never prosper. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talked about the masajid, he said in Surah 36 and up to 38 in Surah An-Nur, Surah number 24, في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع. In houses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave permission to be established. ويذكر فيها اسمه. And his name will be remembered. His name. So when we come to the masjid, we are here to remember Allah. To learn who is Allah. To draw closer to Allah. To bring hearts together. To find excuses for each other. Not to try to find mistakes for each other. That's what Islam is. That's the role of an Islamic center, a masjid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فيه رجال. So in those masajid, there are real men. Last thing that I want to share with you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Those who come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who believe in Allah and the last day, because they know that there is two angels here recording everything that they say. Nothing is missing. And they will be confronted with this on the day of judgment. So they watch out every word that comes out of their mouth. So the word ya'mur, the scholars of tafsir said, it doesn't mean that they just come to the masjid. No, they believe in the message of the masjid. And I conclude with this, the masjid is not a place to do sujood only, or to do the rituals. The masjid is a place that welcomes everyone, Muslim and Muslim, young and old. Children, women, elderly. The Prophet ﷺ was praying one time and he said, إِنِّي لَأَدْخُلُ فِي الصَّلَاةِ وَأَنْوِي أَنْ أُطِيلَ فِيهَا. I come to the masjid and I intend to start my salah and my intention is to make it long. فَأَسْمَعُ بُكَاءَ الطِّفْلِ. Did you hear what I'm saying? And I hear the cry of a baby. فَأَتَجَوَّزُ فِي صَلَاتِي. رحمة بقلب أمه. So I make my salah short out of mercy to the heart of his mother. Because the heart of his mother will be broken by hearing the baby crying. We learn two things from this hadith. Women are allowed and they should have a space in the masjid. Second, children should be allowed in the masjid. It's not a place where the elderly would like to pray in peace and enjoy their five times a day and that's it. The Prophet ﷺ was giving the khutbah like this. Al-Hasan was crawling all the way. The Prophet ﷺ stepped down, he carried him, and he continued his khutbah. Imagine if an imam does this today. Why? This deen is not about coming to pray. The action is that prayer teaches you mercy. And the Prophet ﷺ was merciful to his grandson. One time he was praying Isha and he went in sujood and they said his sujood was too long to the degree that we thought that he passed away. And after the salah they asked him, Prophet of Allah, that sajda was very long. He said, yes, Al-Hussein rode me as a camel in my sujood and I hated to stop his enjoyment. I waited until he stepped down, then I went up from my sujood. Is it about salah or about changing the heart? That's our deen. Let's stop our culture and throw it back home. The Prophet ﷺ chose the right person in the right place. So the imam is the one who is in charge of the masjid. He's the one who decides everything inside the masjid. Abdullah ibn Talb and Umar ibn Khattab, both of them dreamt by the adhan. First time the adhan was given. Did the Prophet ﷺ ask either of them to give the adhan? No. Who did he choose to give the adhan? Bilal ibn Rabah. Why? Because his voice was nice. So when we choose a mu'adhin, we choose somebody with a nice voice. We choose a mu'adhin, you know, whose words will touch the people, will not do the opposite. So if something happens, we shouldn't take it personal. And when we are here together and the imam is not here because he's doing something outside, I said, who should lead the salah? It shouldn't be an issue. If somebody who speaks Arabic, we shouldn't be fanatic to our own culture and get somebody else to lead the salah because he's from my culture, because he doesn't know how to read Al-Fatiha. We should ask the Arab person, not because he's an Arab, because he's the most qualified to lead the salah, because he can read at least Al-Fatiha properly. Because the other person who reads the Fatiha not properly, his salah himself is invalid. Everybody behind him will get the ajr, but he will not get the ajr. Let's leave the culture. Let's purify our hearts. Let's go back to our religion. Let's give each one his role. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who listen to the speech and follow the best of it. Allahumma la tad'a lana wa lihadirina dhanban illa ghafarta wa la ayban illa satarta ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا ميتا إلا رحمته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا ضالا إلا هديته ولا ميتا إلا رحمته ولا حاجنا لك رضا ولنا صلاحا إلا يسرتها برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. ارزقنا توبة قبل الموت وشهادة عند الموت وجنة ونعيما بعد الموت. اللهم ارحمنا فوق الأرض وتحت الأرض ويوم العرض عليك. اللهم لا تفضحنا بين خلقك ولا بين يديك. اللهم اجعل آخر كلامنا من الدنيا لا إله إلا الله. وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.